This is an introduction to Microsoft Excel version 2010, part 1 of 3. In this part, I'm going to introduce the spreadsheet and more specifically the cells. A spreadsheet, like the one shown here, is a set of cells which are these small boxes arranged into rows and columns. These cells extend almost infinitely in each direction. However, no matter how far that you go, it's still considered one spreadsheet. When you have multiple spreadsheets, as shown by the tabs at the bottom of the screen, they make up one workbook. So this is one workbook with three spreadsheets. Using a spreadsheet with cells arranged in rows and columns makes it far easier to work with large data sets and lists than it would be if you were calculating on paper. It also simplifies complicated or repetitive calculations where you need to use multiple formulas on one data set or the same formula on multiple data. And because the cells are simple to format and manipulate, it's a lot easier to read and interact with the data, especially for graphing. Graphing, however, will be covered in a different video. Now with the cells, each cell is completely self-enclosed, which means whatever is entered in one cell can only be accessed by another cell if specifically told by the user. For example, I'm going to enter something in the cell named A1. Double-clicking on the cell puts it in enter mode, where you can type in it. As you can see, when I typed in the cell, it showed up both in the cell and also in the formula bar. Now, another way to enter in the cell is to type it directly in the formula bar rather than the cell, and it works the same way. As you can see, the cells around these are still empty. Before I go on, I'm going to move to sheet 2 of this workbook, where I have some sample data entered. This sheet, which is titled Metric Conversions, has data that is converted from American or standard into metric. The first data is temperature from Fahrenheit to Celsius. The second data is length, which is converted from multiple different units. Now, as you can see, this first cell is named A1, which is shown in the name box here. A1, however, is also its location. A refers to the column, and 1 refers to the row. If I want to go to a different cell, one of the simpler ways to do it is just to scroll down to its location. So if I want to go to D104, I have the column D, and I scroll down till I find 104. That works well when you're using a small data set. However, if you have much larger data, then it's not as convenient to scroll to find the specific location. Another way is to type the location directly into the name cell. For example, if I want cell Q324, I type it up in the name cell and press enter, and I'm automatically taken to cell Q324. The name of a cell can be changed. As an example, I'm going to work with the data that is for the temperature in Fahrenheit. This temperature is 65 degrees, but this cell, which is currently named B4, I'm going to change the name to FAHR, a shortened version of Fahrenheit. I could use the entire name Fahrenheit, but since the name is both long and difficult to spell, there's a possibility that it would be misspelled later, or that it would just get repetitive to type the whole thing over and over. So I press enter, and now this cell has the name of FAHR. If I go to another cell, it still has the name of its location, which is C4. Now, if I want to return to that cell of the temperature of Fahrenheit, I just type in the name box FAHR, and it takes me back to that location. As you can see, it does not matter whether it's capitalized or lowercase. It still takes me back to the cell that has that same name. But I can still find that cell by its location. If I type B4, which was its previous name, and press enter, it will still take me back to that cell, even though that cell no longer has the name B4, since B4 is still its location. One final thing I would like to go over in this video is when the data within a cell is longer than the cell itself. This has happened on this sheet in cell A1, A3, A4, A10, 12, and C8. There are three different ways that this can be remedied. The first is to change the width of the column. When I move my mouse cursor between columns A and B, it changes to this black double arrow. Clicking and dragging allows me to change the width of this column, which now gives room for most of these to fit within the one column. As you can see, however, the name of this spreadsheet still extends beyond the column. I could extend this column further to make room for metric conversions within one cell, but now my data is more difficult to read. Instead, I'm going to wrap the text within the cell so that it takes up what seems to be two lines within one cell. And the button to do that is up here under alignment. The cell has gotten taller to make room for both words within one cell. Since this is the title, however, and nothing will be entered in the cell next to it, I'm going to undo that and just leave it extending beyond to the next empty cell. If something does get entered in the next cell, it will once again cut off what is entered in cell A1. The next location has data that takes up nearly five whole cells, and if anything is entered, it gets cut off. If nothing will be entered in these cells, there is no need to correct this. However, a simple way to fix it is to merge the cells together, which can be done from this button here. Now you can merge and center it, which would change the alignment to center, or merge across. Since we're using just one row, I'm going to merge it across, and now this is one single cell that takes up five columns. Additional formatting, which can be accessed from the tabs at the top, will be covered in the third part of this introduction.